Boston Legal fans. You know what we have tonight? We have one of the big-time Hollywood legends himself. Ladies and gentlemen, you know him as T.J. Hooker, Captain Kirk, and Denny Crane from Boston Legal. Put your hands together for the living legend himself, Mr. William Shatner, Captain Kirk, Denny Crane.
I'm not too sure about the living legend. 6-hour flight from Los Angeles. I'm gonna sit down for a while. My legs are stiff.
We love you, Bill.
I know, but that's not gonna help my legs. But I love you too for being here. That's great. Oh, why are my legs stiff? My grandchild was being named yesterday in the ceremony, so, and I was shooting Boston Legal. It would be like, I don't know the geographical to describe it, but it's about an hour's drive in rush hour traffic on a Friday evening. Ordinarily, it's an hour's drive. So I left the studio at 4 o'clock, intent on getting to the chapel by 6. And I arrived at the building on Wilshire Boulevard, and it was 6:10. I thought, oh no, I can't miss this moment. So I parked, I found a parking spot, and I dashed up the front doors to the front, up the front steps to the front, to the door, and I opened the door, expecting it to. It's a big temple. Doors are locked. Doors are locked. So I run around the side. Still street lights. Oh, still lights locked. I run further down. It's locked. I'm now down a whole block. I'm running. My grandchild, maybe. It's a one-in-a-lifetime opportunity. I've driven for 2 hours. I'm crossing a deserted parking lot. Now I'm stumbling on a downed fence, and I'm running on chicken wire. And then I round the curve, and I come down the other block. I'm now running 4 blocks, and the last possible door is it. And then I run in, and 2 guys are going, and I'm like, there's a chapel. And they go, you go down there, senor. You go down there. And I ran down there, and I ran up, and I ran down. And finally, I got there. Covered in perspiration, dressed something like this, which wasn't too good, and caught sight of my grandchild stumbling out of her mother's arms, going towards the cantor who was singing. And she picked her up, and the little child smiled, and they named her. And I was there in time for everything, but I had run 4 blocks. So now I'm stiff. And old muscles, and I think, I remember when I used to do my own stunts. I'm gonna tell you something. Nobody does their own stunt. How about the Tom Cruise thing about, I do my own stunts? That's inane. If he hurt his finger, they'd say, well, wait a minute, we have to stop here a moment. Stop, hold the cameras. 10 minutes, we gotta bandage Mr. Cruz's finger. What happens if he sort of twists at an angle? Hold on, we have to cut and we have to shoot tomorrow. We have to tape Mr. Cruz. What if he fell 1,000 feet where he said he was dead? I mean, it's just inane. So, nobody does their own stunts. Except me. Now, I don't know what you want from me today. So, why don't I sort of like, what is that bright light? Is that a train coming this way? Let me. Oh, thanks. Do you mind staying there? Oh, no, it's good. Thank you. I'm good. What is that bright white light? Is that necessary? And what about a, could you put an amber gel in it? It looks much better. Skin tones, anything like that? My eyes are so red, I can't believe it. It looks like I'm bleeding from the inside. Maybe I am. So I thought I'd just answer your questions and sort of like we'll get to know each other. That was fast. What's your question? Please tell you about my new show. Well, okay, so some people at Comedy Central, the cable thing, you know that, said, we'd like to do a roast of you. And we only do one roast a year, and it's a very sort of privileged thing, and people who love you will come and we'll have a lot of fun, and we'll pay you very well. And so it all sounded all right. But when George Takei, said, screw you and the horse you rode up in with such vitriol, I thought to myself, what have I done? Why am I here? It's the same thing I'm feeling about Show Me the Money. It's a game show, it's wonderful, and we've given away a lot of money, and I got to know, I got inside the heads of the contestants. I found that was the interesting part, where what are you going to spend the money on? What do you like to do? And, you know, there were some meaningful things. I mean, you got to watch the show. It should be great fun with dancing girls, which makes my wife so jealous. She has no reason to be. All I do is look. This is 18-year-olds go by. So I'm thinking, like, what have I done on Show Me the Money? And until I get a response from the audience, when does it premiere? Next week? This Wednesday? This coming Wednesday? After Dancing with the Stars, like the final thing of Dancing with the Stars. So it's like Dancing with the Stars is ABC's highest rated show, and the finale of Dancing with the Stars should get enormous attention. They call it numbers in Hollywood. And then my show comes on directly afterwards. Huh? It's called Show Me the Money. And so, if it's popular, and if it's well received, then maybe I'll understand what I've done. At the moment, after 14-hour days of recording these things, I thought a game show would be easy. I thought, well, it's an hour game show, you do an hour. Hello, how are you? Answer this question. Oh, no, you didn't do well. Yes, you did well. You won the money. Great, everybody applaud. That's great. And that's it. It's not it. There are so many things to be aware of. And I had to learn. And they had to learn how to run the show. They have a Dutch genius who does all those game shows. The name of the company that produces them is called Endemol. And Endemol does Deal or No Deal. They do. Have you seen Deal or No Deal? Yeah. And it's good. I think he's good, Howie Mandel. I think he's wonderful. So, with me, they had dancing girls, and I got in there and danced, and I got to know some of the contestants and found out this lady wanted to win. I've got to win. I said, why? She says, my boyfriend's right there, so we cut to the boyfriend. And I said, oh, that's your boyfriend? She says, yes. I've got to win because I've got to fix his teeth. Up to now, the hickeys have been very badly shaped. So she's fixing his teeth. So now she's winning money to fix her boyfriend's teeth. How beautiful is that? You really want her to win. She lost. So it's interesting. I never thought it would be that interesting. It's fascinating, except we've got to learn how to do the show better, faster, because two shows a day and 14 hours and I'm dancing around, my feet hurt. That's the first thing that goes. You know, they say your mind, you know, your eyes, your feet go. The balls of your feet get flattened. Your heels get rounded. Well, maybe your heels get rounded. So that's what I'm doing. It's going to be on Wednesday night at, I guess, 9:30 to 11. It's going to be an opening of a show. It's kind of exciting. Will it go? Will it not go? Is it as good as they think it is? I think it's, I haven't seen it, so, and I won't see it because, as you may or may not know, I hate to watch myself. I can't stand with age and weight and years of duty. Can you stand it looking in the mirror? Eh? I mean, those dancers are 18 years old and have slim, toned bodies. They can stand looking at themselves in the mirror. But after 25, and then it gets, and then you get, I just can't stand it. So I don't watch myself. Well, no, yeah, you gotta fog the mirrors up in the bathroom. Another question. Yes, sir. Who's the genius who put us all together on Boston Legal? The genius, and he really is a genius. I've only used the word twice in people I've worked through in my lifetime, and both of them are fairly recently. Ben Folds is a musical genius, and David E. Kelly is a producing, writing genius. He started off as a lawyer in Boston. He was a hockey player. Can you imagine? He's got a busted up face. He looks like an athlete. And he married Michelle Pfeiffer. Thanks. So you think he would have retired after that? You know? I mean, that's a genius right there. Imagine. I married Michelle Pfeiffer. Am I bright or what? But instead, he continued writing, and he wrote things like Ally McBeal. So he won an Emmy one year for Ally McBeal. He wrote all. Usually shows are 22 in number for a season. And so he wrote all 22 shows of Ally McBeal that for several years, but he won an Emmy that year. And then, at the same time, he had a show on called The Practice. And he wrote all 22 of The Practice. And one year, the same year, he won an Emmy for drama. So he had written 44 scripts, probably more, because he had other shows going. But he wrote all 44 teleplays and received 2 Emmys, one for comedy, one for drama, in the same year. So that's the kind of talent that did this. So he introduced, you hear those girls back there? Can you hear them? They were throwing ice around. I kept going, shh, shh, I'm going on. Yeah, okay. And they're there. There's like background music, laughter. So he introduced Alan Shore on Boston, on Practice, because he was thinking of making a pilot called Boston Legal. Then he called me, and I didn't want to do another series, because I didn't want to get involved. The time for me now is like everything. And so having said that, I'm more involved in everything. I can't believe what I have done to myself in terms of the usage of my time. I'm just, I don't know. We'll have to discuss it because I have to explain it. You're going to have to explain it to me. What? I've got several of those words, but I haven't quite combined them. Wait a minute. Okay, go. What's the hardest series? Okay. Well, let me answer this one first. So he calls me down to a hotel in Beverly Hills, and we have breakfast. And he outlines this bizarre character that he wants to put in. And I said, well, I don't know, but okay, 6 shows on The Practice is what he said, and maybe a series, but 6 shows on it. Well, I'll do 6 shows on The Practice. That'd be fun. And do this character. So I did 6 shows on The Practice. Well, Boston Legal sold, and suddenly I was in a series, sort of not half, not really expecting to be. And I had got married 7 years ago. So this is 3 years ago. So Lizzie and I are married about 4 years, and I keep saying, Liz, we gotta go on some adventures. We gotta go to Tahiti, and we gotta go, I've never been to China. I wanna see Japan, and then there's some horses that we gotta ride. And, yeah, Bill, Liz, we're gonna go. We haven't gone yet. And I'm really upset about it. More so than she is. So that's one of the problems of doing this series. And now I've done a game show. Why have I done a game show? Because it seemed like they said, well, you know, we can do them in weekends. And we'll do 3 or 4 weekends. We get all 22 shows done. Do 2 shows a day for 11 days, 3 or 4 weekends, and 3 days a weekend, and you'll have them all done. Well, I could do that. Well, now, of course, it's more than that. The hardest series I've ever done. Well, you know, Star Trek was really hard. Star Trek, just memorizing those lines. Some of the words didn't have any basis in reality. I mean, I don't want to break this to you suddenly. You might want to ease yourself into this knowledge. But Star Trek was pretending. And some of those words were gobbledygook, and sometimes Leonard and I would look at each other and start laughing. This did not sit well with the producers and directors. It was Mr. Roddenberry. So probably Star Trek, with a number of words that I had to memorize and be responsible for a lot of publicity and a lot of stuff. That would probably start crying. Although T.J. Hooker was really tough because we were outside a lot and running around on roofs of buildings, white painted roofs in the summertime in Los Angeles. And one of the co-stars had a bird phobia. He was scared of birds. So now we're on a roof, and he sees a bird. Bill, it's a bird. It's okay. It's okay, it's just a bird. No, no, it's a bird. Can you imagine? I had to take him in my arms gently and soothe his fevered brow. Look at you, stand up in that wonderful uniform. How many hours is that? Well, wait a minute. What do you mean you don't want to say? Aren't you proud of that? All right, then say. Your mother made it. That's what you why you didn't want to say. What? It looks good. Judgment at Nuremberg. Yes, I do remember a little bit of it.
Could you tell us about that?
I met Stanley Kramer, who was a big name in films at the time. He asked me to come in. I don't know where he had seen me, but by that time I was I'm trying to remember the exact sequence of when that film was. I had done Brothers Karamazov, and I'd gotten out of my contract at MGM and went to Broadway, and I believe I starred in the Broadway show then, and then I think that became, sometime a year or so later, that was Judgment on Nuremberg. And so I got this role that at first glance seemed thankless, just sitting around a table while various people spoke for days and days, not unlike Boston Legal, actually. Can't believe it. But he said, you know, this is an important role, and be there, and you're there through the whole movie. Well, I had a chair to see the last of many of those stars who were at that point fading from various ills, some self-inflicted, some not. But Judy Garland, Spencer Tracy, what? Oh, I thought you were going to help help remind me of some of those names. What's his name?
Richard
Widmark. What was the name of the good-looking guy with the bad accident? What was, why did I not be able to, I hate missing a laugh. What did she say? Me. Oh, well, that was a good one. I'm glad somebody, you heard that and pass it on. I shall treasure that as I drive to New York tonight. No, Red River, Montgomery Clift. Montgomery Clift. He was drunk. Everybody was drunk. And I made a terrible faux pas. I did something that only a callow, arrogant actor would do. So Spencer Tracy gets up and he delivers a, many of the shots were limited in time by the amount of film you can put in a camera. So you might, one of those big reels of camera takes about 10 minutes of time before they run out of film. So a take is only 10 minutes long, and Alfred Hitchcock, in the movie Rope, which he tried to do continuously, had to acknowledge that he only had 10-minute takes. So he was able to do it all in one, close-up and wide shots, medium shot, and then dolly into something with the 9.5 minutes of film exposed. You know, very few feet left, he'd dolly into a black robe or something or other, cut, they'd reload the camera, and then they'd rehearse, and then they'd pull away from that, and they'd do something else, and he designed his shots to be aware of the fact, because he was aware of the fact that those film magazines could only carry 10 minutes of viewing time. Well, some of those long speeches in Judgment at Nuremberg were long and maybe more than 10 minutes. So he would set up more multiple cameras. Anyway, Spencer Tracy, what happened there? I suddenly became stereoed. Is that, you can hear me now, right? Okay. So Spencer Tracy delivered a 10-minute monologue as the judge, and when he was finished, everybody applauded, me too. And I had just come back from, I had just been on the stage, and a sort of New York actor arrogance. I never thought that the movie actors memorized their lines. And I was, I don't know what was in my head. And I said, oh, Mr. Tracy, did you learn all those lines? Like some idiot. I mean, he was my hero. And he stopped talking to me. I didn't mean any harm. But, so that his coolness towards me during the movie, maybe it was all in my mind. Anyway, I had the grandest, had the best seat in the house for all these wonderful actors. Burt Lancaster played a German general, and he did a long monologue. You know, we will go down and we will go there, and this is what we're going to do. And we didn't, we're not guilty. We didn't know. And he finishes. Everybody applauds, and we all break. Mr. Burt Lancaster, and good night, Mr. Burt Lancaster. And that's the end of his work. He had only like 1 or 2 days in there. That was the end of the day. Goodbye, Mr. Rick Lancaster, and everybody went, and this is, tomorrow's work is such and such, and we came in the morning, ready to do whatever such and such was, and there was Mr. Rick Lancaster yet. Well, it seems that during the night, he had called Stanley Kramer, and he said, Stanley, I don't think I did it quite right. I'd like to do it again differently. Stanley said, well, come on in, we'll just dress up, we'll do it again. You remember Burt Lancaster, with his teeth and all of that, you know. So he got up and he went on and he started the speech again. We will go there, and we will go here, we will go there, and this is it, we didn't know. It was exactly the same as the day before. And everybody applauded. Goodbye, Mr. Lancaster, it was wonderful, and he left, and that was it. He did exactly the same thing twice. What else? Stanley Kramer. They showed, the writer was, you remember the writer? He was Abby Mann. Abby Mann was the writer of that script. And, you know, I think that was in the 50s or 60s. And a lot of that footage from the war camps had not been shown. Not many people had seen it. It was so gruesome and brutal. Well, they showed it to us for several days in a row. It was required watching. The whole cast and crew watched hours of the film that Americans had made of the concentration camps with all those bodies and all those wizened people. And so it was an emotional film as well for everybody. But in hindsight, what a treasure of American talent. Next question. Yes.
How did you get into free enterprise?
How did I get into free enterprise? Another one of those, what have I done? So these two young guys come to me and they say, we've got this movie and we've got you. And this is actually biographical, they said, because when we were young, we would, these two guys had been friends most of their life. Now they were grown men, about 30. And they said, whenever we would get into trouble, any kind of trouble, we'd play the game of, what would Captain Kirk do? What would Captain Kirk stand up, or would he be smart and stand out? So that's what they played, and that's the script they wrote. So they wrote me, as Shatner, as sort of a character, who was wise. My son, this is what you should do. Go get the girl, bend her over your knee, kiss her soundly, and help your aged father with, you know, they had me so sitting the character in the little wizened thing and yoga. They had me as Yoda. I was Yoda. Well, you know, you see what you want to do, you scared. So I said, gee, I don't want to play Yoda. Why don't you make me into something less, because I don't want to do this film. They said, well, it doesn't work without you. I said, well, I'm sorry. Because they had written it for years. They peddled it around. And the last thing they did was notify me. It's the truth. They spent years trying to make this independent film. They had to get the money. They went all over the world getting money. $100 here, a few thousand dollars there. They finally had got the money. And they said, now we're ready. And I said, excuse me, what's your name again? And they said, Bob. And I said, well, I'm so sorry. I don't want to do this film. And then they kept raising the money. And I said, well, look, if you want me to do the film, you have to rewrite the part. And maybe I'm a film producer as well. Maybe I want to play Oedipus and play all the roles or whatever the play was. So they began to rewrite along the lines of a Shatner character who has ambitions like they have, and it was just another character, and it turned out to be pretty good, and I was happy to do it, you know, with them. But it started off to be something one way and turned 180 degrees the other. And then they've been talking for the last several years. I think they're running around trying to put the money together again. Of doing another version, a sequel to that show, in which I marry one of those guys to a girl, and in order to marry her, I have to go to rabbinical school. So that's the fun of that one, if that should ever go. I don't know. And another question. Yes, my dear. Yes, right, you, right there, yes. You're the only one who's asking a question in this whole crowd. How can you even doubt? What were my thoughts on the Halloween? Was that the lady thing?
Yeah.
The lady. Okay, so here's an interesting character revelation. They say you're going to wear a dress. I don't want to wear a dress. Well, yes, you got to wear a dress. All right, we'll wear a dress. And James is going to wear a dress too. So they try the dress on, and I say, you know, get it up here, get it around there, and we don't want to show bellies and things like that, so make it better. And finally, they got it all on, the wig is on, and I go into makeup. And the makeup guy starts to paint lips. And what are you doing? Well, we're making you up. I look over there, there's James Spader getting made up. He's got false eyelashes on. He's got pink blush on his cheeks. He looks like the most beautiful woman. He really got into it to play a woman. Oh, this is a joke. We're joking here. It's a Halloween party. So I put on no makeup at all. I turned the wig askew. I kind of put the bosoms halfway around, so much so that they kept saying, no, it's too much. I don't understand that phrase. And I just sort of walked around like some idiot. And why do you ask the question? Why are you asking the question? It looked so weird? Well, it was a Halloween costume. I once went out, you know that on the movie Halloween, they used a death mask of me? Are you aware of that? That's actually the truth. But there's more fun when you understand that I used to take my grandkids out for Halloween wearing that mask. And then take it off. Trick or treat! That's the truth. And my grandkids didn't understand it until this day. They don't quite. Why was everybody screaming? You know? But they'll learn. Yes, over there. Okay, we'll do that whole section. There's three of you there. Somebody start. Yes.
How do you feel about them killing off your character in the movie of The Next Generation, Captain Kirk?
Well, I tell you how I felt about them. They said, we're shooting Star Trek VI. You guys aren't in it. We're putting in The Next Generation. And you die, Bill. And you can either be in it or not, but you're going to die. That was pretty heavy-handed, I thought. So I said, all right, I'll be in it. And then they wrote this thing. So they wrote where I got shot in the back, okay? And I fall down and die. Well, about a year before, I was riding in competition in Louisville, Kentucky, at the World Championships. And I was on a young horse, and I was coming back from the ring, and I was coming up an alleyway, and a golf cart was coming towards me, and I was on a young horse. And they don't usually put amateurs on three-year-olds, but this was a particularly docile horse, so they thought it would be all right, and I might go in and win, which I think I did, or came close to winning. Anyway, this horse saw the golf cart and reared. He went up in the air, and I'm up in the air, and I'm losing my balance, and I did the cardinal sin, which I grabbed the reins, and that pulled him over onto me. So, I'm on his back, Horse is going up like this. Ooh. Horse almost pissed on me. I didn't. And I see the horse's head up here, and I'm looking, and now we're going backwards, and I'm thinking, what have I done? And I'm thinking, I'm going to die, crushed. At the last second, the horse falls to the side. My leg is under him. And so from here down to my ankle, I'm underneath the horse. And I scramble out, and the horse rolls and rolls over on me again and rolls back. And they finally get the horse off me. And I go to get up, and I stand up, and I fall down. I thought, I can't feel my legs. This is impossible. I stand up, I fall down. I stand up, and I fall down. Guy jumps on me, says, stay still. You're hurt inside. I said, no, we're sending for an ambulance. I'm not going for an ambulance. He said, you could be bleeding inside. I said, send for an ambulance. So the ambulance comes, and they put me in the gurney, they put me in the back of the ambulance, and now they take off in the streets of Louisville looking for the hospital. And in all the films that I've ever seen, in Rescue 911, okay, when you were in the back of the ambulance, they had it tied down, there was two people there, they were making you feel comfortable, they were nurturing you, and they were giving you oxygen. Not in this case. They had forgotten to tie down the gurney. So as they're going around the curves at 90 miles an hour, I'm slamming against the thing. If I had been dying, I would have been dead. And they finally arrive at the Humana Hospital in Louisville, and there's three doctors standing around the outside having a cigarette. So they said, we got Shatner here. And they said, all right, they're shooting another version of Rescue 911. I'm dying here. They take me and they do all kinds of tests. And finally the doctor comes to me, and I'm sort of half sitting in an emergency cot. And he says, well, you seem to be all right. There seems to be any danger. You're just badly bruised. But we want to make sure you're all right. So we're going to observe you overnight. And I said, I am not staying in a hospital overnight. He says, all right, well, I'll tell you what. Take this bottle and go into the men's room and give us a urine sample to make sure you're not bleeding internally. I said, if I could walk to the men's room, I wouldn't be here. He says, well, there's no problem. And he pulled the curtains around while I urinated into this bottle. And I'm just almost through when the curtains suddenly part, and there's a beautiful nurse looking at me. And she looks at me, she says, oh my God, I'm your biggest fan. So, and you're wondering, what has this got to do with Captain Kirk dying? So I remember the standing up and lying down and, you know, falling down, standing up, falling down. I thought, hey, Captain Kirk, type A personality, he wouldn't accept death. And he'd stand up and fall down. And wow, that could be dramatic. I can do this. So indeed, that's what we did. I stood up and fell down. And the night before, I was sort of thinking how do you play death? You know, the old days, you know, the old westerns. I'm hit, yeah, okay. And the guy dies, you know? And then you began to see them die as people apparently do die, is with the eyes open, the breath, and death comes quickly but silently. I put many dogs who've gotten old down and holding their face in my hands and looking into their eyes, the veterinarian would administer whatever they do to euthanize the dog. And I wanted to be the last thing my beloved dog would see. So I'd be there, and I couldn't tell the difference between when he was alive and when he was dead. It was so silent, and so the margin between life and death is so narrow. So I lay in bed that night before, wondering how to play death. How do you play death? And how would Captain Kirk, more importantly, face death? So I thought, you know, Captain Kirk always went into those weird planets and saw those weird things with awe and wonder. He'd see a new life form instead of going, oh my God, shoot it. He'd go forward. Oh, look at that. Isn't that an interesting life form? Look, it's going to kill me. Not me. Shoot the guy in red, you know what I mean? So I gave that some thought about my own death and what that moment, that marginal moment, when you're conscious enough to know. I had a friend of mine say to her daughter, Victoria, I'm dying, with incredulity. Like, death just came. So what would Captain Kirk do? So when I stood up, fell and stood up, and then fell down, the camera, I had hoped, came in on me, tight and close. I had lived a thing that I thought he might do as he saw death approaching. In this last conscious instance, he might say, oh my. And go out that way. What's his name that did all the drugs? Did a lot of grass.
Timothy Leary.
Do you know what Timothy Leary's last moment was? Of course. And still the mystery remains. So that's what I thought would be a good death. Well, 6 weeks go by, they see the rush, they put it all together. Sorry, it's not working. We're going to reshoot the death. This time they had me fall off a bridge. And the bridge falls on me. And again I tried, oh my. But the camera was so far away, you never saw it. So I was kind of disappointed. Now, I had a talk with J.J. Abrams a while ago. They're writing a new script, and we're all hoping it's going to be wonderful. And he said, you know, we've got to get the Kirk and Spock character in there. And I said, well, how are you going to do that? I'm dead. I said, that's a problem. So they're wrestling with that death. Okay? Now, there was somebody else. Yes, you, sir. That's too complex for me, I don't know. But what's his name who does Pollock. What's his first name?
Kevin Pollock.
So, Kevin Pollock, I was directing a half hour something or other for somebody, a kind of comedic science fiction half hour for a show. And they said, well, who do you want to play the lead? I said, Kevin Pollock. Because he had just been in that movie, where he played a dramatic role. What? Yeah, that was it. Say it again. Usual Suspects, that's it. And I admired him. And I didn't know about the fact that he did an impression on me. So they said, well, do you want to meet him? I said, yeah, I'd like to have lunch with him. So I met Kevin Pollock, and now I'm his director. I'm hiring him. He wants the role. And we're having lunch, and he's kind of looking at me. And I'm looking at him. And he says, are you aware that I've made a living doing an impression of you? said, no, I didn't know that. He said, yeah, I do a really good impression of you. I said, really? He says, in fact, I do a better impression of you than you do. I said, you can't. He says, but I do. I said, you can't. Whatever I do is Shatner. I mean, that's it. You're the impression. I am the suggestion. I mean, I'm there. Well, we laughed about that for years afterwards. I don't know what they're talking about. You know, you remember Jimmy Stewart? Jimmy Stewart would do that. I often wondered whether Jimmy Stewart knew that when he said, pass the salt, whether he knew that he was doing Jimmy Stewart. Like, I don't know what they're talking about when they say, I don't know what that is. I don't do that. They all do it. I don't know what they're talking about. There were times on Star Trek when I couldn't remember the words. So I'd go, and another thing, I'm going to go someplace, as I vainly tried to remember what the next words were. There was a third question there. Oh, you're back up. You look like me trying to die. Oh, George Scott.
And also, I'm just wondering what James Spader did to piss off the Boston legal writing staff that you wound up sitting on his head in a
It could be that James asked them to do it. I mean, I don't know. Andersonville job. So, there was a play based on the book, Andersonville. Written by somebody famous whose name I've now forgotten, but a really fine play that played on Broadway. And George C. Scott was the lead in it. Then, some years, 3, 4, 5 years later, they decided to do it on television on a series that did plays, Hollywood Presents or something like that. They asked me to play the role, and George Scott was going to direct it. So that sounded neat, and I did it. And he was wonderful. He's an actor, he was an actor, and he understood acting, and he understood drama, and he was a wonderful director. What I do remember vividly, though, is at the end of that drama, the part that I was playing, the prosecutor that I was playing, was prosecuting the captain, the head of the Andersonville camp, and it was crimes against humanity theme, and this prosecutor kept saying, "And don't you know? Couldn't you see they were starving? Didn't you know that they didn't have any water? Couldn't you?" And so I approached it like a prosecutor would. "Couldn't you see that? Didn't you know that? You were there." And Richard Basehart playing the head of the camp kept being pushed back. Well, Scott's came to me and he said, "You know what you're doing is what I did for the first year of the run of the Andersonville trials. But what we came to was another version, which was the prosecutor was as agonized over the deaths, the actions of the captain, the deaths of the soldier. So instead of it being a prosecutorial? Yeah. What?
Yeah.
That's the word. Prosecutorial tone, it became more in anguish. Didn't you know? Couldn't you see?" And I fought it for the longest time. I didn't think it was as dramatic. And I don't think I ever did it quite as well as I wanted to, because I didn't quite understand the reasoning behind it. it reminded me of something that actors go through in a long run. I've been in some long runs. I was 2 years on Broadway in a play, and strange things happen in a long run. In a long run. In a long run play. Strange things happen. For example, I was in a scene with a guy, and on opening night, this guy says, and isn't that wonderful? And we laugh, yes, isn't that wonderful? So 2-3 months into it, he says, isn't that wonderful? And he puts a hand on my shoulder. 3 or 4 months after that, it's, isn't that wonderful? And he's clapping me on the shoulder. This guy was a former Olympic swimmer in Australia. I've forgotten his name now. But he began to pound me on the shoulder. And I began to understand that if he didn't get a laugh on that line, he hit me hard. And he began to lose the laugh, because laughs come and go. Laughs are very delicate. And they're ephemeral. And they sometimes they're there and sometimes they're not. You don't know why nobody laughed at the same joke they laughed at last night. Because it's something infinitesimal that you're doing that sets off the rhythm or they don't understand or something like that. So when you do a play on opening night, they call it, they freeze it. That's it. You don't put this bottle over here. If the bottle goes here, you don't put it over there because by a year, it's over here someplace. So you have to be meticulous. Now this guy was clobbering me on the shoulder, which wasn't in when we froze the show at opening night. So I went to the stage manager. I said, you know, he's hitting me on the shoulder. It may seem like nothing, but if you're doing 8 plays a day, a week, and you're looking forward to this, oh, he's going to hit me hard because he didn't get the laugh, it's not fun. He says, I'll speak to him. So I spoke to him, and he wouldn't change. Then I went to Josh Logan, the director, famous director of the time. Josh, he wouldn't do anything. The producer, who was a famous producer, wouldn't do anything. A writer, I went to the union, he wouldn't do anything. A month had gone by and the slaps were getting harder. So I said to this guy, I said, if you hit me one more time on the shoulder, which was never there opening night, I'm going to have to hit you back. In front of 2,500 people. He says, that he took as a challenge. He's an Olympic swimmer. He wasn't going to be bested. So that evening, he claps me twice as hard. I haul off and hit him back. He's so startled that he doesn't do anything. And then the curtain comes down at the end of the first act, and he's charging across the stage, and he takes a swing at me. I duck, and he hits an old prop guy in the head. Guy falls like a stone, and they get him. They pry. They get the guy off the stage and get this guy out of there. And the headlines in the next day in the New York papers was 2 Broadway actors fight. Well, that night, the next night, the producer comes in and says, "Like, you guys got to stop that. That's crazy." So he said, "I'm going to get you all together." I forgot the guy's name. Phil, come on in here. Come into Bill's dressing room. The dressing rooms are little squares, you know, not much bigger than this here. And there's one door. It's a fire door. And you prop it open with a, well, you shouldn't really, but people do for air, prop it open with a wedge. But it's self-closing. So the guy, this big, hulking guy, comes in and he kicks the wedge out. And the door goes clunk. And I'm locked in the room with my nemesis. And the producer is like, oh, oh. I fixated on his jugular. And I thought, I could leap on this guy and bite his jugular. I'm so angry. Well, the producer got in the way and nothing happened. But that's what can happen in a long run. So I thought George Scott had been so tired of playing the prosecutorial tone that he went to something else, which didn't, you know, make as much sense as clapping me on the shoulder. So I never quite got behind his direction on that. Although now when I think about it, I think it made a great deal of sense. I wish I could do it over. Okay? All right. Yes. 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 No. Yes. No. With the hat? Yes. 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 What? Did you throw your voice? Thanks, guys. Hang on, so hang on, say that. This man with a great beard requires respect. I ad-lib all the time. It's just a blank page when I come on, and I ad-lib all my dialogue. I make it up as I go along. And David Kelly is so finicky about his words, and he should be, because if the actor inadvertently or advertently substitutes a word, it's never as good. So that in the past, although it hasn't happened on this show, to my knowledge, every if and, I'm serious about if and but. If the but isn't there before the sentence, it's not as good, and you go back and reshoot it. Now, reshooting is money, and he is paid for reshooting all the time. We, on our first episode, the number one episode, we spent, each show's films in 8 days, we spent 17 days reshooting, and he paid for it. Millions of dollars, because the network only gives you whatever the every hour the you know for the negative cost is what it's called. What were you going to say over there?
Has been.
Well, has been was a really work of passion. It was a weird story. I had done an album called The Transformed Man. And, thanks. Three people out of 500. So, but actually, let me just go into a little detail. It was a concept album in which I thought that the literature, famous literature pieces with music underneath it, would segue into literature of the day, which I thought was song, and I would say the lyrics the way I had said the literature, and it would all be dovetailed by music. And you would get the idea that I was equating Shakespeare, in some cases, Cyrano de Bergerac, Edmund Rostand, and that ilk with some of the really good songs of that year. So that's what I did, and it was released. And then I went on the Johnny Carson show to promote it. And I did a cut. I think it was Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds was the song, and the literature cut was something like Cyrano de Bergerac, whose speech is something about he's a man that stands on his own. And the last lines are, I may climb to no great heights, but I will climb alone. And then it segues into Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds, it was Mr. Tambourine Man, which is a drug song, and the Tambourine Man is a drug dealer. I mean, those are known things by the people who, by the drug culture. They knew what the whole song meant. So I acted the song. So at the end of rehearsal, on the Johnny Carson show, the producer came up to me and he said, you're doing 6 minutes. It's a 6-minute thing. It's 3 minutes too long. Ordinary broadcast on radio is 3-minute cuts. He says, you can only do 3 minutes. So choose either the literature or the song. Oh, my God. But it never occurred to me that they wouldn't understand that I was acting the song. So I said, I'll do the song, thinking it was more commercial. So I got up and did, Mr. Tambourine Man! And Johnny Carson looked over. What the hell is he? You know, the old thing, what am I doing? Yeah. And from then on, it was kind of held up. It was kind of mocked. People laughed at it, except those people like Ben Folds and other people who taught Shakespeare and poetry using the album. So if you were to hear the whole album, some of it's quite good, some of it's quite bad, but the songs make sense if you play the whole cut. Because I was laughed at singing Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds and Mr. Tambourine Man on. So a record company called Rhino Records did Golden Throat record. Okay. So they included Mr. Tambourine Man in it, or Lucy in the Sky with Diamonds. And it was I, along with several other actors trying to sing, were held up to some ridicule. Well, two guys come into my office, and they said, we've sold Rhino Records. We were the head of Rhino Records. We'd like you to do another record. And I thought, these are the mothers who held me up, and they want me to do something, and they'll laugh at it again. But I can get this, I can take this opportunity. And a year before, I had done one number with Ben Folds on a record of his. His record was called Fear of Pop, and I did a number called White Oleander, and it was the hit of the record. So on a modern sort of jazz performer, Ben Folds, who is the darling of the 18 to 34-year-old audience, I became the darling of his darlings with that White Oleander. So these guys are in my office, and the phone rings. And I said, excuse me, I got a phone. It's Ben Folds. I said, wait a minute. Ben, I'm sitting here with the guys from Rhino Records. They've sold their records. They started another record company. They want me to do a record. Will you produce the record for me? And he said, yes, I will. And I said to the guys, would you accept Ben Folds? Said, of course we will. And in that instant, my life was saved, because later on, when I said to Ben, they're going to, you know, the first number of this record is going to be held up under that microscope to see if they can laugh at me again. He said, well, the solution is to tell the truth. And so I wrote many of the songs, most of the songs, from my heart. We recorded it in Nashville. I spent 2 weeks in Nashville in the very studio that Elvis Presley played in. I had the most marvelous, momentous experience, and the record got tremendous reviews. It didn't sell as many as we would have liked, but it got tremendous reviews. So the whole experience was profound, and all because the guys from Rhino thought they were going to have another record tomorrow. How am I doing for time here? What time? I'll take another question. Yes, Dan. Yes. Come here. Come on over here. Just stand in front of us here and show us your uniform. Oh, that's really good. Now, in a nice loud voice, tell us what you want to know.
This might be a hard question.
I doubt it. Here's my opinion, okay? How old are you? 13. I don't think anybody should be a role model. I think you need to take bits and pieces from things you like and admire and fashion your own. Are you listening? You're not looking at me. Who are you looking at over there? I'm giving you an answer from my heart here. What? What's your hands up for? Say you're sorry. Okay. Now listen, I'm giving you a piece of sage advice. I don't think you should choose a role model. I think you should choose bits and pieces of things you admire from various people and fashion your own and be your own role model and do the best you can at all times. If you fall short, you'll just try again. Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. A pleasure being with you.
One more time, Mr. William Shatner.
Seat over. Thanks for waiting, everybody. I thought you guys were all in here listening to somebody else because I could hear somebody talking. Okay, so thank you for coming out. This is only my second convention besides doing, what's it called? Comic-Con, which the network kind of wants us to go to, so. And that's a little different. You don't do as many autograph signings, and they just rush you in and out, you know, as you guys probably know. So, I don't know if we're playing a clip or anything. No clip? Okay. There's no swag to give away. So, I know, I was thinking of bringing something. I was like, okay, what's everyone else going to do if I bring one DVD set? So, I think I'm just going to open it up to questions, because I'm not going to be telling you, yeah, what's necessarily happening. Okay, do I have a mediator to help pick questions? No? All right. You with the baby? I didn't, because I first went out for a couple other characters, and so I didn't really pay attention to Sharon. And then when I finally did get Sharon, I reread the script for her part, and then I read the ending of the miniseries where she comes out and she's a Cylon. And I was floored, because I thought they added that, because I had asked Ron. But it's because, actually, I didn't know what By Your Command really like meant, and after I watched some of the old series, then I realized what it was. So no, I didn't always know. Mm-hmm. Yes. It's Battlestar. You know she's gonna get her baby back. You know, because there's gonna be some tearful, like excruciating moment where she gets, you know, obviously really joy filled. But that'll happen. Yeah. I don't know how long she's gonna get her back for. Yeah, back there. We start, lately we've been kind of starting, the question was like, what's our typical schedule that we shoot? And we've been starting right off the top of April and then end in December, early December with like a month break in the middle.
So you're like just ending next year right now?
We're ending season 3, so we're on the last 3 episodes right now. We're just actually almost in the last 2, and we'll be ending, I think, December... second week of December. Mm-hmm.
Is there a fourth?
Is there a fourth? I don't know. I thought there was like, you know, Eddie almost is like, you, we're going to be in it for like 10 years. And it's like, yeah, okay, Eddie. But everything that Eddie says always comes true, right? So But the thing is, I heard rumor that we're ending like very soon. So that made me really, I know. It made me sad. All of a sudden it was like, and then someone else was like, oh, we don't have good ratings. Like Aaron Douglas, he'll always like have all leak all these crazy rumors. So I'm just like, what? And everyone's like, that's just Aaron. He's the only one saying it. So I don't, but we don't know right now. Mm-hmm. Yes. Favorite episode. I think for last year, Downloaded was one of my favorites, where we got to visit a lot more of the Cylon stuff. Finally, we had a scene where two women were together and not competitive, you know, or trying to hurt each other. Even the, I had a scene with Mary one time. We're like, okay, we're not gonna do what they want us to do, and we're gonna see each other as women, as people, and all this stuff. And then they cut all the stuff out, so it looks like I have a reaction, and all of a sudden she's like on me. And so she looks crazy. One of us always looks crazy. And so it was really nice to have that episode. And plus, it was like the two Cylons on top of that getting together. It wasn't like human-human. It was something that you probably wouldn't expect. So I really like that one a lot. Yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
And you did not know at that time that you were immune because you had a baby who was human.
Okay, we gotta have some sort of spoiler like sign. Okay, so cover your ears. Okay, so about that, yes. Would. Oh. So then I won't say it on the mic then. Okay, how about I answer that one later? Yes? I'll sweep around.
During part of the series, you were playing two Cylons.
Mm-hmm.
The scripts, were they hard to distinguish one from the other?
Yeah, so it was about the distinguishing the Cylons. And I think actually the first season where we had to do that was remarkably easy, and that's because one, I knew they were so different, but one was always pretending to be the other. So in reality, yes, she was hiding something, but at the same time, there wasn't too much that I needed to distinguish them, if anything, like keep them pretty similar. But as season two started coming up, when Sharon, who's now Athena, came back to Galactica, everyone got confused. The director got confused. He's like, well, you know, you've seen Baltar before. And he's like, no, she's never seen it before. He's like, what? And everyone would be like, why not? Like, she just came here. And they're like, okay, right. You know, so okay, that changes that. Or I'd have a scene with someone and be like, oh wait, I've seen you because you were in the lottery scene in the miniseries. Oh, I hate you. Right? You know? Well, it was Baltar, you know, and Boomer before, while she was still alive, I guess. Or maybe after she came back. Oh, I was actually really relieved when they killed Boomer because I thought, phew, I just get one character like everybody else. And then they brought her back and I was like, oh no! What has she been doing this whole time? What has she been thinking? So it's gotten very confusing. Yes.
Could you talk about the new movie you're in? Did BATTLESTAR GALACTICA help or hurt, or was it a problem because of filming?
Okay, so I did a new movie called West 32nd, and it's we shot in New York. And which was so fun because I'm from Vancouver. It's the first time I got to shoot in the States and then a big city. But it's a film, it's a Korean-American film. And some of it's in Korean, some of it's in English. I'm sure they'll have both subtitles. And working on Battlestar, I think it definitely helped because the depth and the width that we go on our show and how raw it is and just bringing things to the table all the time ended up really keeping me either limber or, you know, able to go that deep. And then so when I did stuff on the new movie, the writer even said at the end, he's like, I didn't want to tell you earlier, but you did so much more than I ever even imagined, because it's even hurting my ego. So I was like, okay, that's great. So that was really nice. Yeah. Yes. In a way, yes. So, can you guys all hear the other questions? Okay. It was a question about once we got mainstream attention, So how we felt from going from like a sci-fi genre darling to like a mainstream darling. And we were absolutely thrilled, especially because some of the things that came along weren't, wasn't like Entertainment Tonight or Entertainment Weekly. It was the AFIs, you know, the American Film Institute top 10 show, and the Peabody Awards, and it's like, wow, what is that? We were all like that. It's like, that's big, isn't it? And we would get things that were so lofty compared to what we ever would have thought. So in that way, we were all floored. Even Edward, you know, James Adama, he was saying, he's like, oh, in 41 years, you know, I've never gotten this. And so in a way, it's like, wow. And it's kind of like, do you have an ego? Or is it just still like, wow? I guess it's a little bit of both. He's really humble. So yeah, we didn't expect it at all. Yes. It's funny because Jamie Bamber, who plays Apollo, he loves to throw in the like, Boomer, Athena. He loves to do that just to like, bother my character, which is perfect, you know, because that's what he's used to. And it's kind of funny because sometimes I get a little annoyed, but it's like I feel like such a geek for getting annoyed because I'm just so in the character. Because a publicist will make some comment, and I'll be like, oh, they're all Cylons, don't they know that? And she's like, Grace. It's like, you're such a geek. I'm like, what? I play the character. So, I already forgot your question. Did I answer it? Yeah, you find that amusing? Yes, in the back.
You had, I think, one of the most difficult roles in television. You handled it like a master. I wonder if...
I think so. Thank you. You said I had one of the most difficult roles on TV, and I handled it like a master. Yeah. To a pretty kick-ass school, and I don't mean that it was really great. They like kicked our asses, and they called it, we call it the cult. It was a school in Vancouver, and Atomo, who also, plays Hilo, was also went there, but we certainly did a lot of work doing personalizations, kind of like, we did a lot of method work, so dealing on, and yes, using imagination a lot, but also you're using people like, or substitution, or things from either your past or things that you know, because sometimes that will bring such a charge to it rather than just like, oh, I'm going to imagine that this person is somebody I just really love, you know, because sometimes if you don't really go deep with it, then it doesn't get you, and then it doesn't get anybody else. But that can kind of backfire on you because it takes a lot of effort, it takes a lot of work, and also if you're, you know, if the person you're playing with is going to be killed in the shot, and then you imagine that someone like super close to you, it's like, oh. Like most of your body's like, I'm not gonna go there, I'm not gonna go there. And so you have like four takes of like nothing, and all of a sudden like you trip into it, and it's like, oh my God, we gotta get it. So, yeah, it's kind of difficult. Yes?
Okay, we don't, of course, that Battlestar is not going to roll. My question is, in Battlestar, you've been there for a while, developing the character. For other roles, you've only been in once. Do you have a preference for which way you act?
Oh, you mean all within the show? Or different shows?
Other show. Like, every show you're in, you have different characters. There's a whole new thing that happens
to get. Do you like the variety? Oh, do I like the variety or staying in one show and having the stability? I actually like the variety of having that option or going to, you know, a movie and reading the script and then finish shooting it within a month. You know, it's... Both, they're totally different challenges, and they're really fun. And I think with this show, because, you know, it's going to go a little bit longer, you end up not seeing the cast as probably as much versus, you know, something else you might, like, go to movies and go to karaoke and then go for dinner with the people. But, yeah, character-wise, well, they're both fun. I really enjoy them both. Yeah. Yes. They do always put him on like apple boxes and stuff. He's really short. No, okay. He's very tall. Yeah, he's like 6'2", 3". Yeah, he's pretty tall. I know. You can't tell him that tall. Yes, at the back, red. You? Yeah. How much cast camaraderie? I'm actually surprised there haven't been any, like, hookups. You know what I mean? But I think it's because a lot of the people are married. And actually, a lot of them are just newly married. Trisha got married at the end of the miniseries. She plays number 6. And I got married at the end of the first season. And I thought, do I invite these people or not to my wedding? Because we don't know if we're going to go again. I just have pictures of people, like, I don't really care about anymore. So I... I'm glad I invited them, for the record. And a lot of them did come out. And the ones that didn't, Jamie and James, is mostly because they both had, like, newborns. Like, bam, they came out, like, as soon as we were done. So, yeah, we're all pretty tight. We get invited to their, like, little kids' birthday parties and stuff like that. So, it's good. Yes?
When the script came out that you're going to be searching for becoming human bombs, basically,
well, it was never blurred in my mind. He said about how was the mood on set that day when about the insurgents and people, like suicide bombs, like that. I mean, I think the mood changes when you read the script. You know where you're going into already. But yes, on the day, I think that so much heavy stuff has happened on our show that day in particular didn't resonate necessarily stronger, I think. I know we see it a lot in the news, what's going on in the Middle East. And so, yeah, when we start touching on those things, like, ooh, this is like the Abu Ghraib, you know, episode, or this is the, you know, suicide bomb episode, like, it gets pretty heavy. But, like, I think a lot of the times we are still, as actors, like, we're not walking around like that, like, the whole day. You know, you can't. It'll drive you crazy. I've tried. Drives you crazy. So it's not mega heavy all the time. But once cameras are on, yeah. Yes, in the front. When it's done. My favorite part of acting is watching it. It's so fun. But sometimes you're in a scene and it is going so well that, like, while you're going through it, you're just doing it and you can't really go, oh my god, this is gonna be like, because then you're already, like, it's gone. But once you finish that shot and then, like, with whoever you're with, like Tomo, like, he's all be like, oh, you killed it. Killed it, you know. I'll always be saying that and feeling really good about it, or like coming up with a new idea. But like, I remember that I think after the first season, I wanted to quit, and I always quit. But then I watched a little clip online, like a little trailer with like the music and everything. And then as soon as it was over, I'm like, and that's why I act. This one? Yeah? Oh, right. Well, I wonder if it's because we have a lot of sci-fi that shot in Vancouver. You know, X-Files planted one seed, and we had Dark Angel, and then a bunch of other ones started happening there. So maybe that's why. No? Yeah. Oh, sorry, I'll get you next. I think I used to prefer playing Boomer, but then she's so conflicted that I enjoy Athena a lot more, and I really like her arc, how she's come from such a difficult place, but she has this immense love, and going against a lot of odds that, you know, even today, that she's still dealing with, and I like how she's maturing a lot. And the third character, oh, no. Unless they write it for me, I'm not going to go to them and be like, hey, I have a great idea. Yes?
Are there some actors on the cast that you prefer actively because you have great on-screen chemistry, and are there some that you would like to spend more time with because you don't?
It's funny because I ended up acting with so many of them. I really enjoy watching James Callis work, for instance, because he's so, like, kind of strange and in his head. But also, he'll take a scene, and then once we've blocked it, he'll take the director and, like, have all these other ideas, and you know, not really finish any of his sentences, but you kind of have an idea where it's going. Sometimes he'll give me something to do, which is usually you don't do with the other actors, but it's like, yeah, I would never think that way. It doesn't always work, but you know, it's fun to explore that with him. I like working with Tom. I work with him all the time. And he gives me just like wicked ideas. Like we had this scene where we're in the jail cell, but it was a different jail cell. And he gives me a note, and he wrote a note from Laura Roslin as if it was a note that he found from her written to Apollo that we're going to throw them both out the airlock once we find the answers. And it just like totally got me. So, you know, different people have wicked things that they're doing. And I already got to work with Mary, Eddie. I'll kind of work with everybody. Yeah, it's good. Someone on the side, anybody? Yes.
Grace, you've already shown a lot of range in your talent. I'm just basically wondering, are there any untapped talents to this particular point that you'd like a chance to express? What would be your ideal next role?
Oh, my next role. That's a good question. I think one of the weird things that actors like to do a lot is you like to explore something that you haven't done yet. And I certainly haven't done too much comedy. So I'm doing this play. I'm doing it in Vancouver, but like the character is mentally challenged, and it's kind of like, it's really heartwarming, kind of a comedy style. So I'm really excited to do something like that. But the thing is, I'm not like funny. I'm just kind of more like weird. Kind of like, she's a little eccentric, kind of funny. So I'm not sure just quite yet. You're right, like the range of the show is huge. You get to do so much. Thank you. Yes?
What did you think of the ear jump at the end of the second season?
Hated it. Is that your question? He asked what I thought of the ear jump. I think we all hated it when we first read it. Because David and Ron were trying to not just have a year jump within an episode, but within an act, and they're like, within a scene. You're like, guys. and it wasn't written so that it felt like a year jump. You only knew it was a year jump because there was going to be a caption as a year jump, right? And the things are going to look different. But if you went to the washroom and you came back and you missed that little thing and you're like, okay, what happened? Like, why are they like that? What happened to this character? That would be interesting, like organically shifting psychologically. That's exciting. You know, when you haven't seen someone for a while, they've changed a little bit sometimes, you know? And so I find that, they ended up doing a lot of changes. So yeah, in the end, it's great. Yeah. Do you have your hand up? Yes. Yeah.
Are they pretty much up to you just to figure out from the script that you're not supposed to feel, you know, which way you're swinging now, or is somebody actually we're making you a little more human now, keeping the audience totally confused?
Yeah, they love to it's so confusing because when I think the character is more, you know, we say more human, but let's say more sympathetic to the humans and, you know, not going to stab them in the back, then Eddie, you know, almost will be like, no, you have to do it this way, so that it's totally more convincing. Yeah. Huh? The mic went off. The mic went off. Can you guys hear me?
Which?
Hello? Okay, I'm on. You guys are so easy to please. Come on. Okay. Yeah, it's in my arm. yes.
Yeah. Given the current fast advances in technology, if you ever had the opportunity to go into outer space, would you or wouldn't you?
If it wouldn't take some years off my life, totally. I would totally go into outer space. If I had to spend like $1 million to do it, no. Because I think, can't you do that if you spend a lot of money? 20 million, yes, that's about right. Yeah, I'll wait for like the econo price, maybe at like at Best Buy, we'll go buy a you know, family pack. Slide. I like Expedia myself. Yes. I did a little bit of taekwondo, yeah. I did it in university, but, you know, I'm not going to kick anybody's ass. I had a white belt, okay? And I didn't get the next belt because I'm like, I'm not paying. I know how to do it. But I forgot it. Yeah. We knew they didn't like the old, the new one. I mean, Katie and Eddie were getting like death threats or like hate mail because of that, which is kind of severe. Don't you think? It's one thing to be like, I hate that the new character is a woman, but you know, oh, I don't know. I'm amazed that I didn't get any. They not only changed my character's sex, and then they made like changed the race, the mate of the Cylon, but nobody cared. I wanted some hate mail too.
And,
yeah.
The play that you're doing in Vancouver.
Sorry?
The play you're doing in Vancouver.
Uh-huh.
Could you tell me the name and when you're going to be performing it?
No, because you're going to come and watch. The play I'm doing, it's called The Boys Next Door. And I think we're doing it in January or February. Yeah, and I've never done a play, so yeah, a little bit worried, but a little bit smaller character. It's not like all about me, and it's people in my class that we took it together, so it'll be fun. Yeah, thank you. Yes, I'll see you in the new. It's usually Trisha that's nude. It's barely ever me. I think there was twice, maybe. Yeah, there was a Tai Chi one. And then, like, the whole thing. Okay, and the other one, if you guys ever watched the first season, when Boomer goes down to the planet.
Yeah.
You guys have watched first season?
Yeah.
Okay, before she shoots a Dama, I can say that. And she sees all these naked versions of the base ship. That came about from a dinner that we all went out to, and Michael Reimer, the director, was there. We're like, blah, blah, blah. We went to, like, another spot, we're drinking, and he's like, I think we should do a naked. I'm like, oh, whatever, yeah, sure. Right? He's like, no, I think so. And then the next time it's totally rewritten and they're all naked. Oh, no, and then he's like, I think they should kiss each other. And I was like, Michael, that's retarded. I'm drawing the line there. So we didn't do that. And how do we deal with it? Oh, I don't know, it's fine. I think it's, because I think she's had a lot more like sex scenes and stuff. I'm like Tai Chi, like that's just kind of strange. I think it's because there was a written thing about the Cylons and how to them clothes are kind of just optional. But for some reason we're always clothed, you know, because we're on TV. I guess they know that. So it's fine. I think it's okay, but I thought we were thinking it would be way more interesting if like Leo Bin or Simon was naked, like doing Tai Chi, because that would be like, it's kind of, like, it would be weird, right? That'd be weirder, not like, oh, she's naked again, you know? Yeah. You think that'd be weirder? Like, naked guy? I think, I don't know. Me and James Callis were like, yeah, naked guys. I thought it would just be weird. Yes?
You had mentioned that you had actually applied for the role of Boomer. Can you tell us a little about how you got involved with that
stuff? Yeah, just being a normal actor, you go for whatever auditions you get, and I first got Duala, who's played by Candice McClure. And you know, other name, otherwise known as Dee, and who's now married to Apollo. And I went for her character, and then I got the note from, and the director wasn't there. It was just put on tape. We put on tape, but we did it for casting director. And then he said, come back with Starbuck. And if all goes well, then, or if all goes like he thinks he should, then I'll be in LA the next week. And I was in LA. And then that's when I first met Katie and Jamie. They were both there, because they're doing Starbuck and Apollo at the same time. But it was funny because it was me and Katie and another girl. I think she had like olive skin, right? So us three looked just so different. And I was like, so what are you here for, Starbucks? It's like, what are you here for, like Starbucks? And we're all like, Starbucks. We're like, they really don't know what they want, do they? So different. But I was the only Asian girl, and I got it. Well, I got a different role, but I got one. Yeah, and then so I did get that one, and they gave me Boomer, which I was so not happy with. But of course, I love Boomer. Can you imagine me a Starbuck? No. Yeah. Thanks for the vote of confidence.
How about this side?
No more questions? Okay, yeah, yeah.
I had the opportunity to see Hilo and Chief this summer. They didn't really talk about one. They had lots of ratting on everybody in the show. But they specifically talked about the scene where you were tortured, the attempted rape, how intense it was. And it was so intense for them kind of preparing to rescue you and how they worked up the emotions, and they were ready to like break down the set and rescue you. Mm-hmm. Can you talk about your side of it, what it was? And you had mentioned that they really cut a lot out of the scene and it really did you justice what you guys were filmed and actually worked.
Yeah.
Yeah,
so the scene is the attempted rape scene. And it was written so that it looks like it's just something is about to happen and then she gets, you know, rescued. But since it was that same director that wanted, you know, naked kissing, he was like, how far do you want to take this? And I was like, Michael, I know it's you. You know, let's go all the way. And then so we filmed it that way, which was so much more intense because then everyone know, I mean, when you're filming, you know where it's going to go, and then they can cut it all out, but at the same time, it changes, I think, the energy of it. And but oddly enough, what had been happening that year was there was so many episodes of trauma that I was starting to get a bit burnt out. And funny enough, with that episode, I had kind of a block to it, but I was sort of like a safety block. I wasn't going to, you know, bring some crazy stuff in from the, I didn't have that personally myself, so I didn't have that to draw on, but I kind of knew what they were going to need camera-wise, so I ended up doing what I know needed to be done. But then I was also watching, I don't know if you've ever seen the movie Irreversible, but it's a pretty scary kind of movie, especially if you're a woman. And there's like a 7-minute rape scene in that, and I was watching that in my trailer before we went in. And I was like not, you know, I wasn't like happy. Like I'm always usually happy there. And they came to my trailer and be like, what? And like I was just like so ready to just to do the scene. And I thought it didn't really affect me, but then when I ended up watching the episode later and Fulvio, the actor who plays Lieutenant Thorne, who rapes my character, I saw him in another scene like walking down the hall and I just had this like, ooh, this visceral reaction. I was like, why do I hate that guy? But I totally forgot who he was. I was like, oh my gosh, so it did affect me. But yeah, the scene was intense, but I think it was super intense that, yes, those guys were coming in, but we were improv-ing it a little bit. And what did I want to say about that? Oh yeah, and you didn't even see how those characters were like kicking the ass out of the stunt guys. It was freaky. Domo comes in, and there's like the biggest dude ever on our show, right? He's like, he's massive, he's like so thick, and he just like rolls in. The guy, like he could have hit him as hard as he could and it still wouldn't have affected him. But he like, you know, his whole thing is he had to throw him behind the bed and it looked vicious. And they didn't use that. It looked awesome. I was kind of like, yeah, those are my boys. But they did film this other thing when those guys were kind of getting tortured. It was intense all around because everyone's like using everything, and they had a scene which also got cut down when, because they were supposed to be killed because of that, like put on trial, and Kane, right, was gonna, you know, throw them out the airlock or something. And Tomo had this guy with like the gun in the back of his neck, and the director's like trying to get him to do a little bit more, and so he's like ramming that gun in the back of his neck, and he had this bruise and this like his skin all like was totally, it broke. I mean, they just kept going and going and going. I know, it's kind of crazy. I didn't have that. I just had some weird thing on my back. But I did. Yes?
Do you do your own stunts, and have you gotten enough in the process?
We all like to do our own stunts. But we have stunt people there because they don't like us doing our own stunts. But we watch the stunt people. We're like, oh, get us out there. You know, we're just like, come on, we can do this. It's like, do you want one more? It's like, yeah, we gotta do our own. There's a scene when Trisha and I were fighting, and the other stunt people do it, and it was just like, I mean, they're really good, though. They're amazing. But there was this one thing, because, you know, you're rolling around, like, they kept end up going in the wrong spot, and we did it, and I thought we did it perfect. And so we'll keep asking to do it. Yeah, we get beat up a little bit. We get a lot of bruises. Me and Jamie will, like, compare bruises. We're like, oh, yeah, what about this one? It's like, this one. Oh, this one. It will totally compare. But yeah, I've been kind of laying low lately. Yes?
I know that it was a huge shock for us, like when we shot the drama at the very end of the episode. Do they ever keep things, just in case something leaks out, do they ever like come up with new
Actually, they've never done that, but I heard that we started, people have been taking things from set and selling them on eBay, which made me so, so sad, because our show just has this, just not just a camaraderie, but it's like such a family, and you're there all day, and we don't have very much politics on our show, so it's a really nice place to come to. And when it felt like such a betrayal, because you didn't know who it was, you're like, someone's stealing stuff and then selling it, and you're like, this is so not cool. So they actually started writing fake episodes. And so they have like false episodes. And there's like, it's gone. I can't even tell you what they've done. I'll tell you later once it's all come out. But like the lengths they go to now, I can't even like go into it. It's, yeah, they're trying to keep the suspense alive for everybody, because it just takes a couple people to ruin it, you know? Yeah. Yes, in the very back. I ended up doing a lot of sci-fi TV shows, but that was, in that way I had exposure, but I mean, I watched a couple episodes of Star Trek and watched a movie or two, and I love the X-Files, but I wasn't, and I know you guys are going to be mad at me, but I wasn't a heavy-duty sci-fi fan. I love good sci-fi, but I just wasn't watching, you know, everything. But once you end up going on the shows, and if it's on, you're like, ah, that's Michael Shanks, and that's Christopher. Ah, look at you. So it's more like that. But yeah, I guess just naturally before Battlestar, I wasn't a heavy-duty sci-fi fan, but of course, it's always growing. And so much more stuff is sci-fi now, it feels like. Yeah. Yes? No. My agent just was like, he wouldn't even give me like my flight time. Like he did. And I'd be like, dude, I'm missing the second half. And he's like, here you go. And I'd be like, I don't see any of it. And then I was at the airport and they're like, what's your hotel? And I was like, I don't know. And they're like, we need a hotel for you to go. I was like, I just like made something up. And then I was like, I don't even know if we're getting picked up in the airport. I'm like, I hope so. So no, the last thing I was getting is any advice. Yes.
Do you ever want to keep in touch with people that you work with on other shows and follow their careers and corollary, do you go back and watch stuff that people on past now have done?
Not so much. I mean, I saw Blade Runner again, and I have Dances with Wolves, but I haven't watched it. I've just been carrying it around for 2 years. But no, I haven't really, I don't totally actively follow the new, the other people from other shows. But if I see them on something, yeah, for sure, I'll totally support them. I'm very supportive of just all actors in general. I don't like it to be so competitive because it's really easy to go in that direction. No? Yes?
How old were you when the acting bug bit? What are the highlights kind of from
then
to where you are now?
Acting bug was actually after university. So like I didn't ever want to be an actor when I was younger, and the highlights, I got it right after I wanted to start. I started doing a class, and then I got a Vancouver series called Edgemont. It's like a teen series with like Kristen Krug, who's on Smallville, and some other very, very talented actors on the show as well. That one, and then I did like a smattering of sci-fi shows, which I didn't even realize I was doing sci-fi. And then Battlestar. So that's been my main thing. And then hopefully now branching out to movies. Yes.
Recently Battlestar is a weapon zone. And I wondered what you thought of that and directing that stuff. And you wanted it, but what if you get to do more of those in the future, or how do you?
I haven't actually seen any of the webisodes. Has anyone seen webisodes here? Yeah, are they good?
Yeah.
Okay. I haven't gotten to see them. I think it's a great idea. I love that we're doing that. Yeah, anything to flush it out. I think more on the DVD would be good. Because I heard DVD sets pretty, you know, yeah, pretty thin. How you guys feeling? You guys like kind of getting low on energy here? Should everyone stand up and stretch? Too much effort, right? Okay, who's stretching? Who has a question? Yes. Yeah, I think he said he was wasn't going to do any of this sci-fi. That's what he, you know, because after he goes, well, after Blade Runner. But, you know, rightfully so. I don't know. He likes to think that Sharon's baby is actually his baby. He does. And now they're spending time together in the brig. Well, not anymore, but... Trippy. No more questions? Okay, yes.
Do you ever listen to Ron's
podcasts? Sometimes, yeah. I download them and then I don't listen to them. I have a problem with that. But it's very interesting. One time I actually sat with him on the plane and just picked his brain the whole time. He's so quiet, it's almost like uncomfortable. But as soon as you ask him, it's like turning him on. No. It's not like he's been waiting or he's pent up. He just starts talking. It's like one of those little dolls you pull that little thing. Very smart man. Yes. I seem bulkier? I seem bulkier. Oh, on the show I'm bulkier. We have like a 50-pound like rubber green suit on with like a 20-pound helmet. Yeah. Yeah, I think it's partly the clothes, you know, the belt, the vest. We're running, we're tackling people sometimes. We've got guns, I think that sometimes does it. And also they say the camera adds 20 pounds or 10 pounds, whatever. I don't know how much it does. But yeah, people just, when you meet them in real life, it's like you see them so much thinner because you can kind of see like the air on both sides of them. And on a screen, they're just flat, right? Yeah. Yes. Let's take a poll. Who likes him with mustache? Who likes him without? Yeah. The rest of you just don't like it at all. Yeah, that mustache is hilarious. And then when he grows his hair out, he's funny. Yes? That's kind of difficult. There's been so many things that are happening. But I think one of the really memorable ones was when Sharon's baby died. I didn't really think I would be that connected to that. And it actually didn't cut very well, I think, when it went to air. But the two writers were there, and they said, like, these, you know, pretty prim guys were just, like, crying behind the monitor, which is nice, you know? It's like, yeah, that's what you make us do. This is what you put us through. Cry. It was good. I really liked that one. And of course, shooting Eddie was awesome. But that was kind of better watching it afterwards than... So great. Yes?
Trisha has a story where she met a guy in the convenience store and he ran screaming at him.
I don't think he was screaming, but yes. He was buying something and then he just left the store. He didn't even buy what he was gonna, he didn't even do what he was there to do.
Do you have any stories like that where a fan has recognized you and have been really funny to you? How they
react? I have like stories like other people. Apparently, Tomo was filling up with gas and someone was like, hey, aren't you on Battlestar? He's like, yeah. He's like, hey, check this out. And he flipped open his phone and my Maxim photo was there. I was like, that's kind of weird. What else have I had? I don't know. I haven't gotten a lot. Like, because living in Vancouver and on the West Coast in Canada, with the air is at kind of a bad time. It's changed now, like just really recently, last month. But yeah, haven't been getting that much. So it's been nice, just kind of walk around doing whatever. I think if anything, it's like when if you're in an area you don't think you're gonna be recognized, and then you do get recognized, people don't realize how they watch you. So it's kind of weird. Like, I was on the subway in New York, and somebody was, like, looking at me, and I was like, you like, just, you know, you don't, it's kind of weird. So you kind of look, and then you're like, hey, guy's still staring at me. And you kind of look at him to be polite, and you look away, and you're finally just about to be like, all right, I'm going to freaking pound this guy. And he's like, are you a Battlestar? And you're like, oh, jeez, so sorry. I'm like, yes, yes I am. You know, to teach me a lesson. It's always different though. But yeah, the other day I got kind of, I was buying Halloween stuff, and it was like three people at once, like, I don't know where it's like, hey, Sharon, blah, blah, blah. Someone's like, blah, blah, and someone's like, hey, are you going incognito? And I was like, dude, I live here. I'm just trying to buy a Halloween costume. It was just like, and then I was just talking to him because we were in line to buy something, and he like sweated maybe a good cup, you know? But maybe he just worked out. I'm like, he's still sweating. He just went for a run, you know? He was just nonstop, just like going, and I was just like, I almost wanted to go here. Oh, I got that for you. But yeah, I just didn't say anything.
Yeah.
Yes.
And do you know anything that we don't know yet?
Well, actually, truthfully, it's probably no. We didn't even know there was a spinoff. It's called Caprica, until it came out in the paper. And then other people told us. And it's like, don't you think we would know? It's like, we just saw Ron and David like 2 days ago. They didn't say anything. I think what we know is it's going to be 100 years previous. So they're like, oh, are you going to play Cylons? Like, no, because the Cylons weren't like in human form then yet. And you're going to find out who created the Cylons and who's involved. And it's, do you guys know who created? Ooh.
Which show?
Oh. The new. The old one, they weren't like created by humans, were they? Exactly. By lizards? And I don't know why they didn't keep going. I'm teasing. I'm totally teasing. Come on. Yes. You guys are going to punish me, aren't you?
In your younger life, before you wanted to be an actor, Here we have everybody in that world. Oh, I love this character, this actor. And now you're in their world. Have you met them yet?
Oh, he's like, not yet. I mean, there's a lot of people that, the actor that plays Leobin on our show, one of the Cylons, he has this like weird love interest with Kara. Yeah. I watched him in a few movies. He's a great Canadian actor, and he always has these like weird characters, and I loved him. So when I was working with him, it was kind of trippy. Yeah, because he was like, dude, you're Callum Keith Rennie. What do you say, right? Yeah. Yes?
You were part of the 2006 Screen Awards.
Oh, that wasn't a gig. That was an award show, so we were invited to go down. But I do love horror. I don't watch a lot of it, but I always remember watching like either Exorcist or like Silence of the Lambs or something like when you're really little. Okay, I'm gonna take one more question. I got the sign. But yeah, I do like horror. But that was a really fun show. Everyone came like super gothed out and they're all black. Sweet. Yes. Dean, man. Talking to Dean is like, it's like an ashtray, because he's always on the cigar, right? So you're talking to him, and you're like, da-da-da-da-da. You're like, yeah. And you gotta like, breathe like this, because he just smokes, like, so many cigars. He's a great guy. It's you know, once again, tripping, because he was in so many other shows. But yeah, he's a real sweetie. I think I was a little bit intimidated, but yeah, he's taken to me. Who knows why? Ah, thank you. Thank you so much, everyone. Enjoy your Sunday. It was a lot of fun.
Give it up for Grace Park, ladies and gentlemen. Okay, one couple quick announcements.